my name is Hallie Maynottage, and I'm here today to represent Team Victus as we talk about Mission Arcturus. So, I want to thank you first and foremost for your consideration and your time, and hopefully after this, your money. So, we all know the problem set before us. Earth is dying, and we as humans have overpopulated the Earth, and we have filled it with our trash, and we are destroying Earth's greatest creatures and Earth's greatest environments, and it's no longer sustainable for us to live here. We know that we have to have something else happen. We know that we... Why? ...must learn to live amongst the stars. But inter sideram means to live amongst the stars, and that is exactly what we must do. But when you see this phrase, you're like, where are we gonna live amongst these stars? Well, I'll tell you. We have chosen Mars. Mars is the closest environment to Earth. It's actually often called its sister planet. It has an atmosphere that is different than the moon's, which the moon, our solar satellite, was one of our considerations, but it lacks an atmosphere, and Mars actually has one, even though it's very thin. The length of day is 24 hours and 37 minutes, so it's very similar in that sense, and the average temperature is much colder than what we usually experience, but it's still livable, and most of the soil, if not all of it, has the composition necessary for the nutrients for plant life. And to get there, it would take about a year, but it's still much more hospitable than anywhere else in the solar system. So, we're going to be talking about some of the issues we will be facing as we take this journey to Mars, but we will also talk about how to solve these issues. So, one of the major things we noticed when we were doing our research was radiation. There's two types of radiation that we will mainly be facing. We have solar energy particles and galactic cosmic rays, both of which are very dangerous to people, and both of which could potentially kill us without the proper shielding. So, most of the radiation we will experience will be on the journey. We will experience about 300 millisieverts, which is equal to about 24 CAT scans, which is a whole heck of a lot of radiation, if you do not know that. And then, of course, once we colonize Mars, we will also be experiencing that radiation once again. And so, on Earth, we experience about 360 millirems each year, which equals 0.00036 millisieverts each year. And then this equates to that. And then on Mars, every single day, we experience 0.67 millisieverts each day. And then that equates to 462.2866 millisieverts per year, which is a whole lot of radiation. So that's definitely one big issue we will be facing. So there's another issue that we know is dust storms. So they're not necessarily life-threatening, but they would create a lot of issues that we would experience because they're up to a mile high and they block out the sunlight, so our plants that we plan to grow, our crops, would not be able to grow during this time, especially because these dust storms last from weeks to months, and they're huge, they're a mile high. As you can see in this picture right here, Mars is like completely covered, like it's huge, these dust storms, and the small particles can also get lodged in different mechanisms and pieces on our biodome. Next, we have temperature. The average temperature on Mars is negative 80 degrees Fahrenheit. During the summer, this can reach upwards of 70 degrees Fahrenheit, but at night, it'll drop right back down to negative 100 degrees Fahrenheit. The coldest temperature recorded on Earth is 128.67 in Russia. This was in 1985. And the coldest temperature ever recorded on Mars is negative 195 degrees. So any winter gear that we have had here on Earth would be nothing compared to, it would be no match for what we would face when we are on Mars. Finally, we have pollination. So we know that for our crops, in order for them to grow, they will need to be pollinated. Bees are the survival of plants, but if we can't bring bees with us, then how will the crops survive? Hand pollination, as we've researched, is a long and tedious process, and honestly, it's very the ratio of how often it works to how often it doesn't is very low. Like, it doesn't work at all, usually. So, we don't know how our clocks would survive. Luckily, like I said before, we do have solutions for all of these cons. Our solution for radiation is this. Polyethylene, a material commonly found in stuff like plastic bottle, is super rich in hydrogen, and because of this, the radiation bounces off hydrogen, and so we were considering using polyethylene within shielding. Lead has a huge and high number of electrons that also block out radiation, and recently, in recent years, lead composite shielding has started to become a thing, and so this lead composite can be made into garments that are about 25% lighter than lead, but still have the same impact on the radiation. Metals such as tin, antimony, tungsten, and bismuth are also absorb and block radiation, and so we are considering building our biodome out of several of these. And then finally, foods that are rich in antioxidants very much help this if we have our people on our biodome consume these things. For dust storms, they're not actually that bad. The highest wind speed recorded was only ever 60 miles per hour, and the average wind speed is only 19 miles per hour. And that may seem a little fast, but because there's a thin atmosphere, there's little to no effect. So let's say 20 miles per hour would only feel like 5 miles per hour. The massive storms also only happen once every 3 years, which is every 5.5 Earth years, so it's not very often. And then when they do happen, we could just come up with simple covering for our exposed machinery and ventilation, like this one. And of course, we know that these need to be made out of non-metals because they will oxidize if they are metals. Our solution for temperature, we will have an insulated biodome. And the other cool thing about this is that when we take off to launch towards Mars, we will be protected from burning up during this takeoff. We also have noted that there will be minimal outdoor activity, only to go back and forth between our greenhouses. All spacesuits will also be insulated. Plants will be in greenhouses with provided heat so that they can grow, and plants with specific needs will be put inside of the biodome, assuming that the crop is necessary slash beneficial overall. Finally, for pollination, it turns out bees are extremely adaptable. In 1984, there was an experiment on the Challenger in which they took bees into space. And initially, the bees had a big issue adjusting to the microgravity. They couldn't fly, and they weren't producing their honeycomb or anything like that. But within 7 days, within just a simple week, the bees had completely adjusted, had formed their own flying patterns, were able to create honeycomb in the same geocentric patterns and thickness and all that, that here on Earth, as they were able to do that in space as well. And the queen even laid 35 eggs at the end of 7 days. And so what we've seen is that bees would actually work very well in space. So next we have our environment. Like, what is Mars like? So the atmosphere, like I said before, it's extremely thin. And because of that, there's little to no radiation protection, which is why we would need to shield. That has mainly composed of carbon dioxide, which is not so good for us, but really good for plants to grow in. And because it's so thin, it gives consistency to the temperature, so we'll never have something that's completely unexpected happen within that temperature area. It oxidizes metals, which is why a majority of what we build will need to be made out of non-metals, because if it oxidizes, it rusts and eventually fades away, and we do not want that. And that's actually what causes the red shade of the planet, is all the iron ore within the planet has oxidized over time, which is why it is red. And another thing we noted when we were doing our research is that drag is greatly reduced for moving machinery. So when we move things along the surface, when we land, when we do all of these things to set up our colony on Mars, we will not have to worry about drag. Length of day, because it's so close to an Earth day, we're really happy about that, because we won't have people thrown off of their circadian rhythm. When you're thrown off of your circadian rhythm, it could cause sleep disorders, headaches, and all these other awful things, mental disorders, and we would not want that for the people who will be taking a part on this journey. And when people are kept on their circadian rhythm, they're more efficient, they have decreased stress, distress, less gastrointestinal distress, and less headaches. So resources on Mars. Mars is actually very rich in the resource department, especially for plants. Mars soil actually has all the necessary nutrients to grow plants, which is very helpful considering we won't have to transport our own soil. We have certain nutrients that absorb water from the atmosphere and release oxygen, and a large percentage of iron compared to Earth's percentage. So we have lots of iron that we can use as well. I will now turn this over to my fellow presenter, Kaylee Jacob, to tell you about the rest of our project.
Hello, I'm here to talk about where we will be living when we are on Mars. Although we did say that it is a biodome, to be more specific, it is a rotating biodome that we have taken the model of the Stanford torus from. In order to keep our gravity, we wanted to create something that would do more than just pressurize our systems. So using this donut-shaped ring, essentially, we are going to create our own artificial gravity. When in space, it will rotate once per minute to provide between 0.9 and 1 G of artificial gravity, which is perfect for human habitation. As you can see, the circle is what will be what we will actually be habitating. And all the various circles are the rockets, and the lines going between the center circle and the concentric circle is what will stabilize our environment. When we're in space, this is how our habitation will be. Because the side is where all the gravity will be shifted towards, this is where we will have, this is where we will be habitating. However, once we enter Mars' atmosphere, we did need to take into account the Mars gravity, although it is minimal compared to Earth's. Oh, and this is another diagram from the Stanford torus. Although Mars' gravity is very significant compared to Earth's, we still want to take that into account. Our other teammate, Akari, has a diagram of what it will be like. So while we're in space, we will be at essentially a 90 degree angle. However, once we land, we will be at a lesser angle due to the Mars gravity. We're able to find out the force of the torus needed to accommodate to have that same Earth gravity using simple trigonometrics, the Pythagorean theorem. And through trigonometry, we're able to actually find the angle at which we would be inclined. Although it is some of an angle is only 68 degrees compared, which is much less than what the expected 45 degree angle would be. So it won't be much of a change when we land. So the acceleration between the head and the foot must be a maximum of 1% difference. This prevents any sorts of head injuries or disorders or lightheadedness. So what we did was we found the acceleration of what would happen to, of what would be on the outside circle, and then we calculated for how it would be for a person who was 2 meters of height. After doing simple calculations, finding the difference, it was only in the thousandths of a percentage that was different. And when using the same equation for a 1.5 meter person, the percentage was even lower at being in the 10,000ths. The flight. There are many difficulties for the flight. How are we going to get such a large mechanism into space? It is 1.8 kilometers wide, and it will weigh over 10 billion tons itself. We will need an additional 2 billion tons for the establishment of our colony. So our solution to creating equilibrium between the liftoff, we will need multiple rockets. They'll be 450 meters tall, 40 meters wide, and provide 3.3 billion feet per pound of force apiece. There will be 12 SRBs to provide 40 billion feet per pound of force, and they're required to just exit Earth's atmosphere at around 150,000 feet elevation, these rockets will separate from the torus to get rid of any unnecessary weight. There will be four additional Victus SRBs. You can see them at the center here. They will provide propulsion for our journey to Mars. There will be eight onboard nuclear-powered turbojet engines that will take control of the piloting and smooth landing of the Taurus. These different turbojet engines will provide enough thrust to control the aircraft while remaining within the weight capacity. The colony itself is a big issue, knowing what is going to happen and where. We will divide up into eight different sectors, each containing 1,250 people. They will be on the sides of the Taurus, although they will move at the landing. We will have small health clinics in each sector. This includes both medicines and psychiatry, two large hospitals, four cafeterias per sector. For the people itself, our goal is to provide a sustainable colony in which being mentally, physically, and socially balanced is a living while living on Mars. Each person will attain a job, live in provided living quarters. They will have the ability to socialize, to exercise when they want. They are able to have families and are actually supported to have families, and they will be able to sustain their normal relationships. We will need to provide health tests for each person who is coming on the Taurus. We do not want any people with allergies in case something happens. We do not want major respiratory disease, as they will be experiencing different levels of oxygen than normal, and we do not want any serious health issues, such as cancer or anything that's an autoimmune disease. We do want them to be mentally stable, because this is going to be a lot of stress on them as they go through all these different changes. And we do want people who have hit and have gone past the pubescent stage, maybe because their body is still developing, their hormones are still developing, and we do not want to put unnecessary stress on them. We will have 10,000 people. We would like to have equal ratios of male to female for just reproduction and sustainability of the colony. We would like to have 20% doctors. This is not only medical surgeons, however, this is including psychiatrists, nutritionists, dietitians, people who just will help our colony thrive. We'll have 40% scientists to make sure that everything is stable, engineers to help us with the architecture of the different biodomes and structures, and then the last 25% will be laborers to do a lot of the menial work and sustainability. We will have three different types of living spaces. There will be a living space for singles, which is similar to a college dormitory, where there will be a common living area and then individual spaces. We'll have a living space for families, which is a larger living area, individual rooms for children, and then larger rooms for couples. And then for just couples without children, it'll be smaller apartment-style housing and single bedrooms and bathrooms. Rather than having individual kitchens in each person's house, we'll have cafeterias instead. This way we can make sure that people are not getting more or less of what they need. It ensures adequate nutrition. And our main source of protein will be crickets. Although it does sound disgusting at first, when you look at crickets, they require mineral feed, water, and space for production. If you look at a cricket farm compared to a beef farm or cattle farm, for 100 pounds of feed, you can get 60 pounds of edible cricket feed. Protein, and for 100 pounds of feed for a cow, you only get 5 pounds of beef. A cricket farm only needs 1 gallon of water for a 5x5 dimension of space, whereas one cow requires 2,000 gallons of water for an individual cow. And whereas cows need large lands to graze, crickets are able to habitat small spaces and reproduce rapidly. They have 17 amino acids, vitamin B12, 21 grams of protein per 100 grams, although that is less than a cow's 24 grams of protein per 100 serving, per 100 grams. Considering how much resources they require, it is vastly great. They are very rich in riboflavin, which prevents anemia, fatigue, nerve damage, inflammation, and many other issues. and it only takes 6 weeks until they're fully able to harvest, and they can be frozen for easy access. They're easily turned into flour tubes and cookies, bars, drinks, etc. And if you do make a standard batch of cookies with 3 cups of cricket flour only, each cookie with just the cricket flour will have 6.6 grams of protein per cookie. For agriculture, we'll use the various caverns that Mars has, as they're protected from higher levels of radiation while still sustaining the same nutrient levels. The greenhouses will be inside the caverns, and they will have artificial lighting and heating. And we'll have multiple greenhouses to suit the optimal environment for our different plants, such as artichokes typically survive in cooler climates, so we won't use as much heating, whereas goji berries will prefer drier, hot climates. Both of these foods are antioxidant rich, along with various beans and russet potatoes. And these will mainly be for crops that I choose that need either drying environments or more acidic soil. Aquaponics will be a main source of protein and various vegetable and a vegetable matter that we need for our diet. We chose between carnivorous and herbivorous fish. Carnivorous require more space per fish. However, they do need less food and less maintenance. However, because they are carnivorous, they cannot be in a community tank. Herbivores, they do require very little protein per feed. However, due to their anatomical structure, they can only carry so much food in their stomachs, and thus they will need more feedings per day. For our crop selection, we chose a very wide variety. Beans. For the benefits, they require minimal nutrients, they can provide nitrogen, great source of various vitamins, potassium, fiber, and they only require very slightly acidic soil, which will be okay for our fish. Warm, consistent moisture and at least 6 to 8 hours of sunlight, which is very easy to provide. Kale, as you know, is one of the greatest superfoods of right now, so I'm sure everyone knows all of these, but again, high iron, vitamin K, anti-inflammatory cardiovascular support, vitamins A, calcium, and it's just a great detoxifying food. pH of it is, again, slightly acidic, but this is no problem, and around 70 degrees Fahrenheit, which is perfectly adaptable for our plants, or for our fish. Broccoli, the old health trend, just various vitamins, minerals, omega-3 fatty acids, which is somewhat rare in plant life, zinc, calcium, iron, niacin, which we have not yet gone over, and selenium. The temperatures are a bit cooler, however, we can have cooling systems in that tank for broccoli. Again, similar pH levels. And our final crop will be rice. Because this is such a versatile carbohydrate that can suit many different people, it is a great source of energy, and it actually does help with cancer prevention. It is rich in vitamins and aids in cardiovascular health. It does require flowing water, which is perfect for the aquaponic system. Although it is slightly labor intensive, it is not a very fussy plant. It can be very adaptable. pH range is 6 to 6.7, and the temperature is between 60 and 80 degrees. So in conclusion, we believe that our Mars Taurus was very, our rotating biodome is a very sound argument. We think we have special reference to the NASA, ESA, and NSS, and various image sources. We'd also like to thank our director, Frederick Herman, and our assisting math major is Riley Alcos. We hope that you will choose our project to support. I just want to thank you guys for taking the time, because this is a project we really worked hard on, and my name's Akari Shimizu.
My name is Nina Charles.
My name is Brianne Laurel.
Taylor Mabuti.
Kayla Jacob.
And I'm Hallie Nottage.
Okay, so, well, thanks for the presentation. It's really impressive all what you've done. And I have a couple of questions, just a curiosity of some of the designs that that you presented here. One of them is, two specific ones, regarding the spacecraft, the space station, let's call it. So for what I understood, what you are trying to do is to take the whole structure from the Earth and just lift it off. Have you thought about the advantages of maybe having something on a space like intermediate station and build this structure on a space? Is there any advantage of having that instead of lifting the whole structure from the surface of the Earth? Have you thought about those possibilities?
Our main reasoning behind assembling it on Earth and rather taking it up, although it requires huge amounts of force just to get it out of the atmosphere, the main reasoning behind that is because just the sheer scale of it, being about 10 billion tons itself, the torus is just huge. So for that reason, the actual process of putting it together, we thought that it would be easier to do here on the surface of Earth rather than to have the facilities and equipment to do that in space. So that was the reason behind that.
Okay. And the other question that I have is about, so you've talked a lot about the kind of food that you want to grow, how to deal with the environment, etc. But, you didn't mention anything about energy sources that what you're going to use once you are on Mars. Are you thinking about using kind of like solar energy or maybe building a power plant, I don't know, a nuclear fusion power plant on the surface of Mars? Or?
So I would like to focus mainly on solar radiation solar energy for the beginning. One thing is that we later figured out that the torus itself would only need to move roughly 30 miles per hour to attain Earth-like gravity. So that is very little energy put out to get that same amount of gravity for the torus. We would like to continue on with nuclear fusion. However, we did want to kind of capitalize on the solar energy we can get since it's so, in a way, pure due to like lack of atmosphere. Although there will be times with the dust storms kind of interfering with that, we will have like kind of backup generators, just simple things to get us by, make sure that all of our environments are just kept safe and away from major difficulties. We do wish to have like within the 5.5 years, hopefully before the before a dust storm comes in, to hopefully come up with different sources of power besides just solar. However, I believe for the beginning times when we were trying to settle in and make sure that everything is thriving, we will stick with solar power.
Thanks.
My name is Sui. And I have a question regarding the actual problem that you try to solve. At the beginning of the talk, you mentioned that one of the problems on Earth is the pollution, and this is why you want to go to Mars. How are you planning to solve the pollution problem on Mars? If you don't solve the problem, then you have the same problem.
So we do want to rely mostly on recycling for our different sources of water. We'll need to get rid of a few different things. We will, no matter how disgusting this sounds, we will have to recycle waste, even ones that we make, for the sake of water. We will need to let go of some of that, as it is something that cannot be recycle into something new. However, we do try and plan on making everything something that we can recycle, reuse, redo something with. For example, if there's any waste implanted, we will try and create compost for either the plants to help the soil be enriched, or we can give like different food scraps to our cricket farms or to our aquaponics. May I ask more about which kinds of pollution you're talking about?
Well, the pollution that you think that is a problem on Earth, and why are we not using these solutions on Earth, and why do we have to go to Mars? So your justification of the project is not there if you don't have that solution.
Earth can only have so many resources, and we as humans have used up many of them. We've polluted some things to the point where they can't be fixed. We have done a lot of waste into like our oceans, for example, things that just don't degrade naturally. Lots of different glass, even plastics. Even though they're so thin and kind of fragile, they can still do a lot of damage. So just in the case that the Earth has gone too far where it can be salvaged back, this is our escape plan.
Thank you.
First of all, oh my gosh, I can't believe the breadth of information you guys investigated. Very thorough. One question for now is the dome rotating on Mars once it gets there?
Yes, it is.
So it's landing and then spinning still?
Yes, it will be on a sort of structure that will be underneath the space structure itself while it's still rotating in space. And then it will land on that with the help of the jets to kind of let it land softly. However, also because the atmosphere is so thin, we do not really need to worry about burning up in space or when we're landing as we go through the atmosphere.
But it's gonna land and keep rotating to get the grip. So why land? Like what are we getting from Mars?
So Mars does have natural resources. However, one thing is that in space there is just so much debris, and usually on average it'll be 17,500 miles per hour, and any size of debris, because we have no atmosphere to protect us, will injure or will damage our torus. So staying in space can't be a forever thing. Although we can delay it, we will get hit by various different things. Another thing is that although we will have to produce energy on Mars to spin the torus, whereas we wouldn't need to once we're in space as it's a vacuum, because the atmosphere is so thin, we will only need to do 30 miles per hour, which is very easy to accomplish. And it will also reduce drag, which will keep it spinning more with more ease.
Something that would be nice to see then is, what is the plan to get out of the torus? Like, we're gonna spend a bunch of engineering to make it so that we can land and eventually populate the rest of Mars. Because right now it sounds like we get there and we're stuck because we haven't brought enough resources. Like, are we taking it apart and repurposing it? And the gravity is critical, which is why I think you want it. So, is there actually a world where we leave the torus once we land?
There is a world where we leave the torus. We will need to leave to get to various caverns and various agricultural systems. Our plan was for the openings where people would come in, that would also be how they would exit. However, before they actually go into the various, locations where like they live or the various sectors, it will almost be like you have a moving belt, like the escalator belt things like you see at airports or something. That's the best way I can describe it. But just to help you get to that speed, because rather than stopping it then restarting again, we want to kind of keep that momentum to use as little energy as possible. So it's almost like we will try and do multiple things to get you like faster to the torus speed. But we do not want to like stop it just for one person. And we will try to create schedules of time where we say, okay, this sector is going to be available to you in so many hours or something like that.
Well, I guess it's very clear you have so many more ideas that I'm sure we didn't hear. But, thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay.
Hi, we're the students of Makua, Lani. We're the advanced language and composition class. We did already have them introduce themselves, but I'm going to go ahead and have them do it again just for our recording.
Hi, my name is Risa Waddell, and I'm a senior this year.
I'm Barnabas Chen, I'm a junior.
I'm Kelly Chung, and I'm a sophomore.
Whitney O'Halloran, sophomore.
I'm Shantia Skilson, and I'm a sophomore.
Noah Bags, sophomore.
I'm Anjali Hughes, and I am also a sophomore. I was also a team manager for this project, and as we went on doing our project, we eventually decided on the name Errantes Vitam, which in Latin means wandering life. We felt that this kind of embodied the ideals behind our project. So, yeah. Well, we're gonna have Whitney stay and do our business proposal of sorts, and then we'll begin.
So previously you asked the class before us to say what we're doing. So Errantes Vitam is a proposal that will ensure the future of humanity, maximizing comfort and with minimal danger. We aim to create a colony that is independent from Earth's resources, and we will obtain our resources from Saturn's moons, such as Enceladus and Titan, which is where our bases are located. We will also obtain resources from asteroids and from Saturn's rings. Our plan details steps of a hypothetical mission that won't compromise safety and comfort for survivability. I'm just gonna sit down now.
Okay, so without further ado, let's begin. So we're gonna start with a little brief overview of the Latro Botris, which is what we've decided to call our system of communities and colonies, and it means...
the Nomad Cluster.
Yes, it means Nomad Cluster. It will allow us to gather resources, support colonies indefinitely. So here at the beginning, we have the Ark, which will be a preliminary spacecraft launched that will carry an initial... that will carry an initial colony over onto Titan, one of Saturn's moons. It's going to go through the asteroid belt, collecting resources along the way, and it's going to set up some of the buildings and colonies and stuff like that. Next up here we have the SS Exodus, which will be a mile-wide Stanford Taurus that will house our proposed colony of about 10,000 people. We have Titan. Talked about it, Saturn's largest and most habitable moon. This is where the colony will ultimately reside. Enceladus, another one of Saturn's moons, very small. In fact, I think in diameter, it's not much larger than like the big islands of Hawaii. But it is made almost entirely out of water ice, which is a lot of water, which will be able to support our colonies for a long time. Saturn's rings, it's the most extensive planetary rings in the solar system, made mostly of ice, with little bits of rock in it, not much bigger than like a softball or the size of your head, but there is a lot of it. And lastly, we have the asteroid belt. As you probably already know, the asteroid belt is a group of asteroids and exists between the orbits of Mars and Jupiter. It has lots of asteroids in it, and it has different types of asteroids that contain different materials. Yeah.
Do you think you have enough room to go over to the other side so that we can? Yeah. Alright, so we'd like to begin with phase one, which will detail our research and development part of our plan. Phase one will consist of all the research involved in the undertaking of such a monumental project. We would also establish a budget, acquire both candidates and resources, and our resources from the Earth as well as the Moon, and constructing the Ark, which we'll talk about more in depth in a minute.
As far as the acquisition of candidates goes, we plan on vetting them pretty heavily, as they must be like healthy. We must have a good amount of genetic variation so that certain diseases like sickle cell anemia and things like that don't pop up. They have to have like no genetic defects. They have to be mentally stable. They have to be competent. You know, we can't have a bunch of idiots. And they have to be physically able as well.
Okay, so this is our, by our class artist, Shantia Skilson. This is some concept art she did. Sort of a recruitment flyer, if you will, perhaps a type of advertisement to acquire candidates or raise funds, as we attempt to do now.
I made this picture. Not as good, but it's still pretty cool. So this is the Ark. It will begin. It's the preliminary launch spacecraft we talked about. It will arrive at the Latro Botris, the Nomad Cluster. 2 to 3 years prior to the Taurus. It will carry 150, 200 people who will begin the construction of the colony on Titan.
So I would like to address the unique design of the Ark. It'll keep these first colonists healthy. Zero gravity is very detrimental as a health, I'm sure, as many of you know. Causes muscular atrophy, blood loss because of the equal blood distribution. Your brain believes that it has too much, eliminates some of it, and your heart atrophies. And also the straining of the spine, which is not necessarily a problem while you're in space, but as soon as you're out of zero gravity, it does cause major problems. So what we have here, and the best way I can explain this, is with this carnival ride. The carnival ride uses centrifugal force to force people against the walls. It creates an artificial gravity, if you will. So the Ark will use a system best related to this. So it'll be a circular housing section, which will spin, and the centrifugal force will put the force the colonists against the wall. This will simulate gravities, and force will be very near to that of Earth. This will allow us to simulate laying on a bed, and we calculated that the diameter of the system would need to be 100 meters in diameter to prevent a strong blood differential between the front and the back of the colonists. Because there is no up or down in space, even as they're spinning around, there are no dizzy spells. You don't feel dizzy because you don't know that you're spinning.
If the colonists use this system, instead of having to exercise for hours and hours a day to prevent atrophy, and the straightening of the spine, they would have to exercise for maybe only half of that, 2 hours.
So we have...
Again, there we go.
Okay.
Again, here's the picture of the Ark. As you can see, this cylinder right here will be connected to the shuttle, and it will spin around 100 meters across, and it's going to simulate gravity. People will be laying in it, like, this will be your head, and this will be your foot, and it's going to spin around that way.
So, with that, we move on to phase two, which we'll deal with, namely, the assembly of the SS Exodus, which is our Stanford Taurus. So, the Taurus is a revolutionary idea that changed the feasibility of a space colony. Our model will be a mile wide and can easily hold a population of 10,000 people. It's a promising solution to a dying planet, even though we aren't quite at that point yet, because it creates its own artificial gravity because of its rotation and with its use of centrifugal force.
Here's some stats on the Taurus. Here's the original art design, again by Shanti, showing where we might place the agricultural sections, the recreational sections, the engines, and it's going to have several spokes, sort of like a bicycle wheel, in which we can house things like water or rations or food, things like that. Housing will be up here, work district over here, for the different jobs that will be required. We calculated using several different equations that the surface area would be 1,300 miles, the volume will be 90,000 kilometers squared, right? All these things, very large, and plenty of farm space for farms, plenty of space for the people, plenty of space for everything.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, the maximum population is a little bit over 18,000. If we use our proposed colony of 10,000, it means we have about 8,000 people that we could add as the population grows. We still have room on the course. So the SS Exodus will be assembled modularly in space because the mass estimate is 10 million tons. It's almost inconceivable to try and launch that, as well as manufacturing on Earth doesn't work well because you are trying to put everything in a gravity where the bottom is wherever you are. We can't spin the Taurus on Earth at a speed fast enough to put things in the top of the Taurus and for it to stick. So most of the manufacturing will occur on Earth, and the assembly will be modeled after that of the ISS, how it was assembled modularly, contributions from several different countries.
So in space, we're going to assemble it, connect all the pieces, do all that jazz, and then over a period of, and that's going to take about 2 to 3 years for all that construction, and from there it will begin its journey through the asteroid belt and on towards Titan.
Alright, so as far as the general construction of the Taurus goes, because of the dangers of space, space travel, space debris, a 7-layer shell will be used for the outside of the Exodus. The layers in order, the first is used for UV protection, hydrogenated fullerene. It'll be reinforced with polyethylene, which the other team did talk about is present in a lot of plastic bottles, great for its protection against UV radiation, and that layer will be cured with resin. And we have a thermal protection layer, which will be fiberglass cloth encased in a polymer film. And this will also aid with pressure control. And we have Kevlar, provides protection from minor space debris. This is kind of our last resort shield. I'm going to talk about in just a moment what else we have trying to protect us from space debris. Then we have a shield layer. I believe it speaks for itself, but it's made of open cell foam that expands upon transport, and it'll be impact resistant. We have the frame, then a skeleton made of glare, which is an aluminum fiberglass mix, and carbon nanotubes. And our innermost layer will actually be four layers of glass fiber reinforced with rubber bladders.
Oh boy. So onto the Whipple shield, which will be mainly the first line of defense. Even though in space is pretty empty, there's lots of empty space in space, and the asteroid belt is pretty spaced out, so we don't have to worry about a lot of space debris. In the event that we do run into any space debris, we have what we're calling the Whipple shield. It's a thin shield, also known as a meteor deflection screen, and it consists of a bumper, such as a thin sheet of aluminum, standoff, next to Kevlar, and graphene layers inserted between the bumper and the rear wall of the torus.
Just real quick, you want to say the word space one more time?
Space.
Alright. So, our layers, you notice graphene, which is actually, it's carbon nanotube in kind of a fabric form. Carbon nanotubes is something that is, it's fairly new technology. We're not good at mass producing it yet, we're working on it. However, the technological leaps and bounds with which our civilization advances should be able to, by the time we attempt to construct a project of this magnitude, we should have carbon nanotubes mass produced. So what they are is long chains of carbon held together by the strongest bond in all of chemistry, the sp2 bond. It's stronger than the bonds that hold diamond together. So carbon fibers have the highest thermal conductivities, and so they can be used for heat dissipating, which will be very useful, which are with our engines, which we'll talk about in just a moment. It's 300 times stronger than steel, and it will be 17 times stronger than Kevlar. They can be, they can reduce spacecraft weight by 50% or more, which is very significant because, as I said, we're launching all of our pieces and modules up to space, and because it's so heavy, because Earth's escape velocity is so high, it's very difficult to launch very heavy things. In addition to this, one of the other advantages is it will actually help us cut down on our pollution. Damascus Fortune, the company that's making them right now, captures carbon content from industrial and automobile exhaust and converts the exhaust into the product. So this is actually just an example of the Whipple shield. This was put on NASA's Stardust probe.
So as you can see, the Whipple shield, the Stardust probe, you can see how effective it was because the Stardust probe is actually the fastest man-made object to ever travel at any speed. It traveled at a maximum speed of Mach 29, I think, 29 times the speed of sound upon re-entry, and it survived intact.
Very effective.
Okay, so next we have some other controversial technology, I suppose you could say. This is a picture of the prototype plasma engine called Basmir, designed by Franklin Chang Diaz. This is the engine we want to use for our propulsion. The engines will be located in the central hub of the Exodus for maximum efficiency. So this is some stats on the engine. It can go a maximum speed of 34 miles per second. Now the acceleration time is 23 days, so it does take us a while to get there, but in an overall trip of about 2.5 to 3 years, 23 days isn't that big of a deal. It'll go 123,000 miles per hour, and after 10,000 high-powered shots on Earth, it shows no wear and tear, which is very contrary to the chemical engines that are in use today.
Can we talk about how it uses plasma?
No, we did not.
So the engine, basically, it heats up hydrogen, superheats hydrogen gas into plasma, which is how it's reaching such high speeds. It creates a lot of thrust, a lot of speed, and that's how we plan on making it. We're going to use engines and powers and stuff to generate electricity, which we're going to use to heat the hydrogen.
And the hydrogen is available in great amounts on Titan. because they have liquid methane lakes. And we'll talk about methane cracking in just a minute. In addition to this, one of the other plus sides of the plasma engine that it can change course at any time. So that means if we have a stray asteroid, although it's very unlikely, we are able to move out of the way, which is, again, contrary to many of the spacecrafts that are flying now. They fly in an orbit relying on a lot of gravitational pull, and this would be opposite to that, would rely on its own engines.
The Exodus is elliptical, with an outer shield, spokes, and a central hub. Like I said, like a bicycle wheel. The spokes will be made with the structure of carbon nanotubes and covered in the glare substance, the aluminum fiberglass mix that is used on commercial airlines and jets, we talked about it. The central hub will be big enough to house the needed 5 to 10 plasma engines and will be detachable in case of emergency. To ensure maximum hold, the fastenings will also be made of carbon nanotubes.
Yeah, that is our only problem with the plasma engine, is that it does rely on nuclear reactors, and because they are unstable, we need to have a central hub that's able to detach and get away in case of emergency. So now we'd like to move on to the interior of the Exodus, how everything works and how we can keep it self-sustaining. So this is our proposed model of the Taurus, very rough, but this is designed by Shanti. We have a recreational area such as parks, seemingly outdoors life, because the human psyche is so fragile and we need to be reminded of Earth. Agricultural section, which actually takes up the largest amount as far as dedicated to each district. It'll be 199 square kilometers. We have our industrial and professional district, our work district, if you will, and our housing. So because of Earth's gravity, launching things off the Earth is extremely expensive due to the energy required to exit Earth's atmosphere. In an effort to cut down on the cost, we would like to mine the moon for its regolith, which consists of
oxygen, silicon, calcium, aluminum, magnesium, and trace other elements. We can mine the lunar soil for these and launch them over to where the construction of the Taurus is, so that we can use it instead of launching it up from Earth.
So our method of launching the things off the moon is actually very interesting, although it does sound very medieval. The electromagnetic catapult is one of our best options. So we would launch materials using a mass driver or an electromagnetic catapult. It's one of the best proposed methods of non-rocket space launch. It uses a linear motor to accelerate and catapult payloads at high speeds. Right now, all existing models use coils of wire that are energized by electricity to make electromagnets. So the payload continues to move due to momentum. And I was going to talk about Lagrange points.
Yes, I'm going to talk about Lagrange points for a second before we continue. Lagrange points are points in space where the gravity of two separate celestial bodies sort of negates each other, and something can exist in that point without being affected by the gravity. It won't be pulled in towards something or pulled out towards the other thing, it'll just stay where it is. So a mass catcher at the Lagrange point between Earth and the Sun would collect the materials, it's actually very close, it's called L2, Lagrange point 2, and transport them to L5, where they could be processed in an industrial facility to construct the Taurus. This way we don't have to rely on engines keeping them in place, and we can always know where they are.
Yeah, so the electromagnetic catapult system is most famously and extensively used on aircraft carriers, helping jets to go fast enough in their small amount of space to be able to actually catch flight. So our next thing to address, kind of our problem, was agriculture. So all farming will be done in a vertical farming system. It uses the Exodus available space to its highest capacity. Vertical farming will allow us to grow much more in a much smaller space, allowing us to provide food for 10,000 people on an available 199 square kilometers of available farmland.
These are the plants that would most efficiently provide for our needs on the Taurus. We have quinoa, buckwheat, soybeans, rice and beans. All these things are very rich in protein and are very efficient when it comes to consuming them and getting lots of nutrients and stuff out of them. In addition to providing food, the agricultural system will also be a part of the waste management system, using the waste to fertilize plants.
So the next thing, of course, is a self-sustaining colony does need oxygen. Because Titan does not actually have any present oxygen, this is one of our biggest obstacles that we tried to figure out if we could recycle our atmosphere, what it would cost, what it would take to actually indefinitely sustain our colony. So approximately 10 acres of full-grown trees will indefinitely support a colony of 10,000 people with surplus. If we plant 20 acres, we allow for growth of the colony, and this will take up less than 1 square kilometer.
Yeah, so one leaf produces about 5 milliliters of oxygen per hour. The average human needs 50 liters of oxygen per hour. Now that's 10,000 leaves per person. But the average tree has about 20,000 leaves, which means one person can support about 2 people. So we figured out how many trees we could reasonably fit in an area of about 10 acres, and we figured out it would be more than enough.
So we have another concept art by Shanti. This is our proposed aquaponic system. It's too risky to bring farm animals into space onto the Taurus because they produce too much waste, take up too much food, and they can cause disease. However, this is our alternate system that we propose, aquaponics, to produce both fish and plants.
Fish produced waste that turns into nitrates and ammonia. If this builds up too much, it hurts the fish. However, the nitrates and ammonia are really good for the plants. It makes a really good fertilizer, and it prevents the buildup of ammonia and nitrates. As the plants suck up the nutrients, it cleanses the water for the fish.
So the fish that we propose using are tilapia, Murray cod, white bass, and catfish, which would do best. However, we'd also like to include salmon and tuna. Salmon, as you probably know, is a freshwater, saltwater fish. And tuna, although considered a saltwater fish, there are so-called freshwater tuna present in Lake Nicaragua, in Nicaragua, as I'm sure you guessed. So we would see about having these tuna and being able to have them adapt to life in freshwater, because tuna and salmon would provide not only alternate choices, but omega-3 fatty acids that we would desperately need.
Yeah, fish do well in space as well. They do well in zero gravity. So on to phase 3, the travel phase. Our proposed launch time is 2 to 3 years after the launch time of the Ark, with travel time being roughly 3 years, because we ought to account for the acceleration of the exodus. Yes, that's exodus. And also the deceleration, because if we accelerate too fast, it harms the people inside, and if we don't decelerate, we will crash into the Titan.
So this is yet another piece of concept art by Shanti, showing our traveling SS Exodus to Saturn with our little Titan up there. Phase 4. That was a quick one. So phase 4 is the actual colonization of the Latra Botris, which again means the Nomad Cluster. So once we reach it, we do need to begin colonizing it. This is our proposed system. Well, if you could move that way for a little bit so they can be able to see this. So we have Saturn for Saturn's rings, which we would use for water, as well as Enceladus. We have our Stanford Taurus here, the Ark, with rest of the L1 Lagrange point, and Titan, where our base would be, which we would use for methane and hydrogen. So this is just the distances between the different parts of our system. It takes 44 hours to go from Saturn to Titan. Now this is using a chemical rocket. If we could find a way, then I do believe that we will, to harness plasma engines, put them on smaller crafts, use a more stable nuclear reactor, then we would be able to move a lot faster. So this is our placement. We put the Taurus on a geostationary orbit with Titan, and we do have the numbers on that. They were on the previous slide. Barnabas calculated that. So the reason for our geostationary orbit would be to remain in constant communication with the base on Titan. We want to be facing the same side of Titan at all times, and the Ark will rest at the L1 Lagrange point. This is some more travel times between the members of our system. You can see that it will take 2 hours and 40 minutes to go from the Taurus and the Titan on a geostationary orbit.
Alright, now on to the housing system and colonies on Titan itself. We plan on making them modular and easy to manufacture, sort of like tents. They'd be able to sort of like pop up easily, and we could interconnect them with their modular design. As you can see, there's tubes connecting them all. There will be different modules, each for different purposes. We'll have a greenhouse, like sort of tent sort of structure. It's not an actual tent. And we'll also have smaller ones for residential areas. They can be as large as like several stories high and as small as like small buildings, like the size of this room. So the atmosphere of Titan is about 50% thicker than Earth's, and it's mostly composed of nitrogen. And Titan also rests inside of Saturn's magnetic field, which shields it from radiation. So our little colony here would not have to worry about radiation. So we don't have to add costly shields into the structure of the tents. Also, Titan is tidally locked to Saturn, meaning it doesn't rotate. Its face, the same face, always faces Saturn's face, which means there's not a lot of wind being generated. So we don't need to make them be able to withstand wind either, meaning we can make them lighter and easier to build. We plan on making them out of like hard plastics and aluminum alloys, similar to what satellites are made out of. And we also plan on making them be able to utilize geothermal generators, because Titan does have a molten core. We can take advantage of that. Also, Titan is filled to the brim with liquid methane, which we can also utilize. And also human dynamo power. As it has low gravity, we'll need to exercise, and we can also take advantage of that.
And we're going to talk about that right now. So, as I said before, zero gravity, or near zero gravity as it is on Titan, is very dangerous to our health, muscular atrophy, straightening of the spine. So this is the time on Titan that relates to the exercise time. So
one of the main concerns on Titan was the surface temperature, which averages at about negative 250 degrees Fahrenheit, that is, which is really cold. Okay. However, we have a solution in aerogel. Aerogel in its pure form by itself is brittle and it's really expensive. However, there exists a polymer, silica aerogel polymers, which is capable of insulating the human body, many times like more efficient than things like asbestos and other insulators. It can actually support humans in temperatures of up to negative 350 degrees Fahrenheit because it's such a good insulator.
So the approximate cost of each aerosuit calculated by RISA is $73 with a gas mask. Because Titan's atmospheric pressure is so similar to our own, we don't actually need pressure suits. So it'd be like wearing kind of a full-length scuba suit and a gas mask. Oh, goodness. Oh, okay. And our price would be under $100.
Per suit.
So, again, oxygen. It's a very big problem on Titan. Titan's atmosphere is 95% nitrogen, and the remaining 5% is split between methane and hydrogen. Our solution to this was algae. Algae produces 60 to 70% of the world's oxygen, and 20 liters of algae and water spread across 8 square meters supports one person indefinitely. This sounds like a lot, but with efficient farming techniques, it's totally accomplishable.
Yeah, actually, on this algae thing, NASA itself, also with SpaceX, which I believe is Elon Musk's company, are trying to find ways of producing oxygen on Mars, because it's something in the real world that they're actually trying to do. And one of their proposed systems for creating oxygen on Mars is algae. So you can see it's actually something that could be very viable.
So quite a majority of the algae that we want to grow would be spirulina, because it contains all the amino acids and is a complete protein. It also withstands and continues to grow under radiation.
So as I discussed previously, Titan is covered in liquid methane lakes because of its extremely low temperature. The methane can be harvested and converted for its molecular components, namely hydrogen and carbon, using a process called methane crack. This involves the separation of the methane components at temperatures of over 750 degrees Celsius, around 1300 degrees Fahrenheit, without harmful emissions. Steam emitted from this cracking will reach about 1000 degrees Celsius, and which we can take advantage of for energy, steam energy.
The hydrogen will also be helped to fuel our plasma engines. So, to ensure the continued sustainability of the colony, to be able to completely and indefinitely survive on its own without any help from Earth, we plan on mining from Enceladus and Saturn's rings.
This is an image provided by Shanti, again, of what the mining crafts may look like, harvesting hydrogen and water ice from Enceladus, your Saturn up here, going onto the surface, scrubbing the ice, melting it, taking it up, and then flying back to the Ark or whatever Nexus is nearby.
So because of the Ark's design that prevents muscular atrophy and the straightening of the spine, after the base on Titan is secure in itself, the Ark will be converted into a hub for mining crafts. This will allow the colonists, the miners, to go on long journeys to collect different resources, and that would bring down the health risk of that trip because it would, again, help them with the artificial gravity.
So Enceladus, like I talked about earlier, it's almost entirely made of fresh, clean ice, perfect for providing water, something we can't really easily create ourselves.
So this is Saturn's rings, are mostly ice with trace rock particles. It's easily filtered, and again, an extensive water supply. And once industrialization begins on Titan, the asteroid belt can be mined for its content. It may seem very far away, however, the journey with plasma engines is cut short. Using the Ark, there's little to no health risk, and it would allow us to, again, remain completely independent from Earth.
Finally, we have Phase 5. The continued sustainability and growth of electro cultures.
So this is our system. We'd like to invite our team back up so that you guys can ask any questions. We can perhaps collectively answer them if we can't answer them on our own. All of our team, if you come on this side, did their own independent research. We came together every day, discussed what we had, tried to figure out what we were missing, and trying to the waste that's emitted from everything isn't waste. It's something that we can use because we have little to no resources that we start out with.
So I have a couple of questions again. One is about growing trees. I understand that one of the things that you want to do is growing trees on Titan, but is that correct?
We're proposing to grow them on the Stanford Taurus. This would allow them time to grow as we transport the Taurus, and it would also, because the temperatures can be artificially created, the entire environment can be simulated in the Taurus. It's very easy to control. We can keep the trees in peak growing season all year round if we put them on the Taurus.
Okay, also,
trees are aesthetically pleasing and helpful to the human psyche because space sickness is a thing, like sort of space fever, cabin fever, whatever you want to call it. And having an area where they could go out and be in the trees and stuff would also be helpful for them.
Okay, so they're going to be on the station, and then they're going to be used to feed people living on Titan. That's more
so
the idea.
So the oxygen will provide the oxygen for the Taurus. The oxygen on Titan will be provided with the algae farms.
Okay, I understand that. So my question is, to be able to grow trees so far away from the sun, have you thought about that? Because you have the problem that the sun radiation, well, you were talking about
how the leaves are efficient
in producing oxygen, but they need the sunlight, so they are not going to have that sunlight. I mean, from Mars is kind of a little bit closer, but if you go as far as Titan, you are really far away from the sun. So how do you get that energy for the trees to grow?
The energy we would use would be from red, green, and blue LED lights, as well as far away red LEDs. Is that correct, Kelly? Yeah. This was her research, actually. And that would provide the energy for the plants to, for the trees especially, to complete photosynthesis.
Okay, that's one question, thank you. And the other one is, why are you thinking about going to asteroids or the Saturn rings or Enceladus to get water? There is also water in Titan, isn't it?
There is some water on the surface of Titan and in it, but it's a lot easier to have the system because we're humans, like, we're going to have to go through a lot of water, and Titan doesn't necessarily have enough of that easily available to us, unlike Saturn's rings, which is easy to harvest. We just need to basically catch it, seeing as they're not very large, we don't need to mine it, and Enceladus, which is a lot of water, more than that sometimes.
Because the escape velocity of Enceladus is so low, it's very easy to harvest it. One of our main goals with this project was to be completely sustainable, completely independent, doesn't need Earth's help at all. We never returned to Earth after our initial departure. So it was very important to us that we find other water resources, a backup to the backup to the backup, if you will.
Have you thought about providing entertainment to your colony?
Yes, actually, if you saw the picture, we had a space set out for recreational areas. We want to make sure that the people on the space station are living in maximum comfort because we need them to be stable, psychologically speaking.
I didn't do it.
We don't know. It's the rec center.
We'll have things like game rooms, community rooms.
Some Pac-Man.
Yeah. this is also where we'd like to have part of this, the bridge right there between agricultural and the rec center would be where our trees would be placed, because that would, again, allow for kind of a park environment to help with the human psyche, and that would also be considered part of agriculture to help provide oxygen.
Well, again, ton of work, so thank you. Just kind of a main, it kind of goes along the line with the trees and the algae, and then we've got like pods that we're making once we get there out of plastics, and then we've got clothing that is a different polymer. It seems like every time you ran into a problem, you came up with like a solution that would work, but then there's like, There seems to be missing just a little bit of consolidation to try to reuse as much as possible. And in the absence of this, are we like going from one environment on, and sorry, what is this, the Ark, into a completely separate and new thing once we get to Titan and like building it up there from scratch? Or are we like taking pieces of the Ark and building
it? So the Ark itself will be converted into a mining craft. This will be used not only once industrialization begins, which we anticipate will happen because of the advanced technology used, the Ark will be used as a mining craft, kind of a hub for the smaller mining crafts because of the kind of sleep system, if you will, that will be able to transport people back to the asteroid belt, be able to mine the asteroids there and bring them back because it is such a long journey.
For sure. So as an example, the housing on Titan.
The housing on Titan,
modular.
Yes, it's modular. It would use that we would all bring, that is original equipment. That would be taken, some of it in the Ark, some of it in the Stanford Taurus, and because they are kind of collapsible, they are kind of pop-up tents, if you will, they are easily storable. And then we're also talking about reusing as far as clothing. The aerogel polymer can be reused, consolidated, and reformed to create more insulation for more housing.
Okay, so you really are building two different systems of living and then transporting one system.
There are several different systems, all interconnected, making like a sort of living, breathing community of...
Yeah.
I think everyone's going to want to stay on the Ark once you get there.
I mean,
seems a lot more comfortable.
It is a bit more comfortable, but due to like space concerns, and we also need people on Titan itself so that they can...
So they can make it livable.
Yeah.
How do you plan to maintain law and order?
That's a good question.
This is a societal question which we didn't actually go into much depth on. However, we did go into some. It would rely on a heavily structured community, especially on the Taurus itself, because it's easily damaged. Arson is one of our biggest dangers. As a matter of fact, if anybody sets fire, the only way we can do it is because we have our thing divided up into sectors. We have sectors which within all of our divisions. And so, like, if a fire is set in one of them, all we can really do is try and stop the fire, but after a certain point, we have to close down that sector to preserve the rest of the Taurus. So all
well,
of our...
we could just release the oxygen from that sector.
Yes.
Shutting out the fire, we could also have, like, emergency oxygen masks in case ever such an emergency arose. But as far as maintaining law and order, I think the standard... That's part of the vetting process, too. Vetting people who are not only, like, mentally stable, but also are willing to cooperate and things like that. But the standard, like America, like police system, would probably be, in fact, that would probably be some people's jobs.
I mean, law and order depends from society to society, how things are run, and I think it would be the same with the Stanford Taurus and with the La Trobotra system, because things are very unique to that system. Something, you're not gonna get arrested on Earth for pouring liquid methane on somebody. It's just very unique.
So are you going to encourage, that's a question for the other teams also, are you going to encourage some sort of commerce or some sort of value-added style of living?
Well, we want to try and create like a community on Titan and on the Exodus, and part of that is having jobs for people, having them do different things. As far as
because you're asking us for money, right?
Yes, so...
So how are you going to pay the money back?
Save the earth.
Oh, you want to...
Save the people.
Yeah, this is like, mainly not as if we just want to, like, colonize space, but Earth is in trouble, sort of. And this is something that we need to do. That's sort of the viewpoint we're coming
this,
from.
Yeah, this isn't really a tourist thing. It could, obviously, the technological advantages could lead to that. But this is more of our... This is our failsafe. This is what we fall back on if we ever do reach that point, which we seem to be getting closer and closer, that Earth is no longer habitable for us.
Yeah, this is sort of like Mr. Herman discussed at the very beginning, the nations are united, more politically stable. This is something that like we'd all come together on and like do as a society on Earth. And like if you want like valuable minerals or something like that, there's plenty of like platinum in the asteroids and the asteroid belt and gold and things like that. But as far as commerce goes, we didn't really
the
put a lot of research
on
into
the,
that.
On the
that's
access
not what we're
itself.
Super worried about.
Yeah.
Can I ask another question, also kind of sociological question? How are you going to deal? I mean, this is supposed to be in a situation in which the Earth is dying and people have to leave.
Yeah.
How are you going to deal with the people who is not going on that?
Well,
I mean, there are going to be only a maximum of like 10,000, 15,000 people. What about the rest of the world?
I hate to sound heartless, but 10,000 people can fit on the Taurus.
Yeah, it's not that easy.
After we left, we're independent from the Earth.
Efforts would be made on Earth to try and fix its situation, but in case they can't fix their situation, we need to have like a colony in case it's too late to get away. We need, right.
And you could call this our initial colony.
Right.
Yeah, this is maybe once better. After we get everything situated, more people could be admitted to come to Titan, but this is just like
yeah.
To figure everything.
Earth is going to try and like fix its problems, but before it gets too late, we want to get people out there, you know?
What is the main feature that you were trying to get from Titan or resource?
Main feature, it's relatively habitable and large and has lots of resources like the methane, like we talked about.
What makes it habitable? Habitable.
Well,
a lot
it's
of it's
the
atmosphere.
Habitable.
Yeah, the most. A lot of it, though, is the atmospheric pressure. Because
it's also relatively safe from radiation.
It's
yes.
Super thick. That's
radiation, right. The radiation and atmospheric pressure are both huge bonuses for us as far as Titan goes, and because they're rock formations, Titan itself is easily terraformed.
So you eventually plan to terraform the atmosphere too? And
long term.
Yes.
Long term.
Eventually we're going to try and make a society, a community that like is closest to what we have like on Earth, but in space. Another way that we could do that is releasing some of our emissions that we don't need, greenhouse gases, into the atmosphere of Titan, which would help it warm up, actually.
Thank you so much for listening.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I am awarding 70,000 of florins to Team Erantes Ritum and 30,000 to Victus. I like the presentation of the Erantes Ritum team better. I feel that the organization of the project is better managed. The phases are clear. It has a longer vision in terms of the project itself, of the goals of the project, saving mankind and the long-term objectives of the saving the earth is clearly presented. I feel that the teamwork is also better. And while the Victor's teams have presented pros and cons, which is not in the Arantes team, I like that. But in at the end is I feel that 70% and 30% is my choice.
Well, I guess I'll start with the explanation first and then award the money at the end. Just trying to break down the problem was a little bit difficult for me to follow on both teams because I got to hear a lot of what the decisions were, but had no way to tie that back to any like top level constraints that we were dealing with. So like if we think that nutrition is a constraint and you guys spend a lot of time dealing with nutrition, there's a whole bunch of, and Team Victus is has a whole bunch of different plants that you want, but I don't know what the actual meal balance that we were trying to make was. And there's a comment that you threw in like, oh, and broccoli needs a colder temperature, so we'll be able to cool that. Well, was broccoli actually something super critical that is worth extra weight and energy to be able to make? And you can justify that case, but I almost think of this as like a spreadsheet where you really need to write down, here's how much each decision contributes to some big resource pool. And I felt like there was a little bit more of that is it Arantes?
Arantes.
Even though I didn't see it, and it might just be because of the presentation, but the presentation was a little more organized and it felt like the decisions kind of were more in line and more justified. But I'm going to award 60% to Arantes and 40% to Victus because I think Arantes's structure will actually get built and the spacecraft, I like the construction plan, but I don't think we should go to Titan. I'm hoping that you'll go bankrupt and we can give it to Victus to carry on the population. So, thank you.
Okay, well, so I'm gonna start actually with what I've awarded and then I'll give a little bit of an explanation. But I'm gonna give 60,000 to Victus and 40,000 to Errantes Vitam. I really like both projects and I think you guys thought really a lot about how this can be made possible. You thought a lot about how to feed the people that is going to be traveling on those spacecraft and going to be living in those very hazardous environments, and that's very nice. as well to see how you did all your calculations and thought about the amount of nutrients that people might need in these kind of missions. But my decision comes more from the point of view that I see the mission to Titan really less realistic than the mission to Mars. I mean, of course it counts how the presentation was made, but thinking in practical terms, what can be done in a realistic medium to short term, Mars seems to be a more friendly environment in terms of gravity, in terms of distance, and the complexity of the mission is, I find it maybe in the long term could be very good to have a space station around Titan, plus people living in Titan, plus mining in asteroids and the Saturn rings, but in a short term I really see that very complex. While the mission to Mars is something you build a spacecraft, go to Mars, have a permanent station on Mars, and then you can travel from the station to the surface of Mars. The only thing that I like least of the Victus option is the fact of I still don't see how you can build such a huge spacecraft on the Earth and then try to lift it off. So I would recommend to use the other approach, the approach of the other team, which I really liked it a lot, and is let's use space. In a space there is no gravity, so we don't need to we don't have problem of structural problems with our spacecraft because we are in zero gravity. So I think it will be easier to build the spacecraft on space than to build it on Earth and then trying to lift it off, and probably less energy consuming as well. So basically that's my verdict.